You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Siame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Monday, the 16th of November, 2020, 33rd week in ordinary time. And today we remember two saints, Saint Margaret of Scotland and Saint Gertrude, Virgin. Margaret was born in 1046 in Hungary, where her father was exiled from England. Later, the family returned to England, and in 1070, she was given in marriage to Malcolm III, King of the Scots. She was a good and caring mother of eight children, as well as a great queen, devoting her time, energy, and resources to the poor. She died in the year 1093. Gertrude was one of the great mystics of the 13th century. She was born in Saxony in the year 1256 and later joined the Cistercian Abbey of Elfter, where she lived the whole of her life. At the age of 25, she started having revelations and visions and wrote extensively about them. Devoting her life to God, she dedicated herself to the pursuit of perfection and gave herself over to prayer and contemplation. She died in 1301. Let us pray. O God, who prepared a delightful dwelling for yourself in the heart of the Virgin Saint Gertrude and your holy woman, Saint Margaret, graciously bring light through their intercession to the darkness of our hearts, that we may joyfully experience you present and at work within us, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading will be taken by Best Hamuletwa, a Daily Bread member from Monze, Zambia.
The beginning of the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, and chapter 2, verses 1 to 5a. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants what must soon take place. And he made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is he who lives around the ways of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written therein. For the time is near. John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. I heard the Lord saying to me, to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear evil men, but have tested those who call themselves apostles but are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary, but I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then, from what you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel passage will be taken by Father Muyunda Musilekwa, a Daily Bread member from the Diocese of Livingstone, Zambia, studying in Kerala, India.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A proclamation from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Luke chapter 18, verses 35-43. It happened that as Jesus drew near to Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. And hearing a multitude going by, he inquired what this meant. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." And he cried, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And those who were in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stepped and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, let me receive my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has made you well." And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
From today until Saturday, the 28th of November, we'll be dealing with the book of Revelation, Apocalypse as it is known. And Apocalypse is just a Greek word for disclosure, for unveiling, for revelation. We are taking up this book, which has been misunderstood by so many people, misquoted, misused by so many people who have not known what exactly this is saying, because it is apocalyptic, it is symbolic, it has to be understood. Many people quote Revelation. Whenever something happens, they want to quote Revelation and say, the world is coming to an end, just as the book of Revelation says. Hold on. You better understand. It is not to be taken literally, because it is written in symbolisms. Look at the numbers that I use. 7 for perfection, 6 for imperfection, 5 for affliction, and then 4 for the earth. All these are just numbers that I used. 12 for Israel, 1,000 for uncountable numbers, a great number. And when you hear of 144,000, we just say it's a numerical number. No, it is not. It is referring to an uncountable number of the new Israel. And so we will have to look at this. We will have to look at the word of God as it is written, and for us to understand why the writer wrote the way he did. Indications are that the book was composed in the first century, towards the end of the reign of the Emperor Domitian, who lived about 81-96 AD as an emperor. And that was a time when emperor worship got a new impulse from local governors in Asia Minor. The first beast found in chapter 13, verse 1-10, and Babylon the harlot found in chapter 17, probably refer to the Roman Empire insofar as it imposes an idolatrous emperor worship. The official propagators of the cult are portrayed in the second beast, also called the false prophet and seducer, found in chapter 13, verse 11 to 17, and then chapter 19, verse 20. Now, the book presents itself as a letter to the seven churches in Asia, with an introduction and conclusion. From the start, it must have been destined for public reading, as we find in chapter 1, verse 3 that we are going to read today. On the other hand, the book owes much to the prophetic oracle style and the popular apocalyptic writing, starting from Daniel. So, if we are to understand this, we go to the book of Daniel and understand the context in which Daniel wrote that. So the writer here was writing to the Christians who were going through persecutions at the time, went through a lot of trouble. The Christians who suffered under the emperors, Nero from 54 to 68 AD, and after killing so many Christians, this emperor committed suicide in 68 AD. After Nero's suicide, Vespasian took over up to 79 AD. And from there we had Emperor Domitian. And all these emperors were persecuting Christians. It was around that time that the writer of the book of Revelation put on paper what we have today. It was meant to encourage the Christians of the time. And all those images you see in the book of Revelation were referring to the people who were there at that time. Therefore, it would be very incorrect to consider Revelation as a forecast of future history or to try to identify its symbolic characters with historical persons of the present, of the recent past, or the immediate future. No, that is misunderstanding scripture. All that the book tells us of the future is that the people of God will encounter opposition and even persecution throughout the course of their history. That they, by the omnipotent power of God, will triumph in the end, and that Christ will judge the world when he comes in glory to bring human history to its divinely destined conclusion. In other words, the book contains no revelation that is not already to be found in the other books of the New Testament. The author has chosen to present these truths in the form of apocalyptic visions of disaster, of triumph, in order to make them as dramatically vivid as possible for his readers in the late first century. These Christians were being persecuted by the half-mad Roman Emperor Domitian. And you know what? Domitian was considered to be the other Nero. He was that terrible. And they needed that encouragement. And definitely we will need this encouragement from the book of Revelation as we go through another emperor today. The COVID-19 is a terrible emperor. The COVID-19, I would name it Nero in our time. It has paralyzed many things. It has paralyzed us. But we won't allow it to paralyze us. We have Christ to encourage us in the book of Revelation we are going to consider in the coming days. The one we have started reading today is an encouragement written to the church at Ephesus. The Lord says, I know your works. I have seen your endurance. I have seen how you have persevered in the trials, in the trying moments of life. You have been faring well. Your toil and your patient endurance. And you cannot bear evil men, but have tested those who call themselves apostles, but are not, and found them to be false. Oh, you have been very diligent. You have had the spirit of discernment. But I have a problem with you. I hold this against you. You have lost the first love. Wow. I hold this against you. You have lost the first love. You have forgotten the love that you had at first. And I want you to restore that love. I want you to go back to the enthusiasm that you had when you got baptized. I want you to go back to the enthusiasm that you had when you just got that marriage. I want you to go back and restore the fire that you had when you were given those vows as a religious. When you received those vows as a religious, when you committed yourself as a nun, as a sister, I want you to go back to that fire. I want you to restore things as if they were just beginning. Whenever you find yourself losing your energy, whenever you find yourself losing your commitment, enthusiasm, your vital energy within that made you start that journey, go back. Go back to that love that fired you up, that made you want to belong to God. The many things that are happening in our world today cannot affect what we know of our God. Cannot affect the faith that we have. We have to remain enthusiastic. We have to remain fired up. Because we know the God we believe in, and this God we believe in wants us never to lose any fire, never to lose that love that we had when we gave ourselves to Christ in our baptism. We want to restore that love. The gospel passage of today shows us how we can restore that love. We learn from this blind man at Jericho. Sometimes we want to understand everything. Sometimes we want to have everything in perspective. But you know, you won't have everything in perspective if you don't have faith. Faith is not sight. Faith is not perceptible. No. The blind man asked, "Who is that?" "It is Jesus of Nazareth passing by." And so he shouted, "Son of David, have pity on me." This man was blind, and yet he was able to have that faith. So you see, you don't have to see for you to believe. You don't have to have miracles for you to believe. Even with your blindness, even when you cannot see God's power at work in your life, you can believe. And let other people guide you. Let other people who are experiencing Christ, who are walking with Christ, guide you. Listen to them. Follow what you hear being done, being said. What is that? Oh, it is an audio coming from Father Eustace. May I listen to it? What is that? Oh, it is a praise and worship song. May I listen to it? Have that curiosity of wanting to know and wanting to have everything that has to do with Christ. Whatever has to do with Christ, follow that. Gospel music, follow that. There are people who say, "No, I just want the church music from my own church. I just want the song from my own church. No, I'm a Catholic. I only listen to Catholic songs. No, I'm an Anglican. I only listen to Anglican songs. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I only listen to the Seventh-day Adventist songs. You know, that's me." No, listen. Open up. This man was not in the company of Jesus, but he asked, "What is that?" "It is Jesus passing by." Okay, that's the commotion about. Let me listen to him. "Have pity on me, son of David." And these people were trying to stop him. As many people would try to stop you with your blind faith. As many people would try to discourage you by the negative feedbacks that they give, by the terrible things they put on social media, for you just to lose your faith and for you to stop calling upon the name of Jesus. This man despite the discouragement, despite the many things that were being said by these people, he shouted all the more louder, "Have pity on me." And Jesus came to him. He knew this was a beggar. He knew this man had been sitting there to ask for money. And maybe he had found somebody very famous, Jesus, with such a big following. He must be rich. He must be having money. Maybe he will give me something big enough for me not to be coming here anymore. "Son of David, have pity on me. What do you want me to do for you?" It's a very serious question. And you know, Jesus now wants a prayer point. Jesus wants the prayer point to be clarified by this man. Many of you say, "Pray for me, Father. Pray for me." But how will I pray for you if you don't give me the prayer point? You have to be specific. And Jesus wants us to be specific in our requests. Don't just shout. What are you looking for from him? "Lord, that I may see." Oh, wow. "Lord, that I may see." I want to see. That is the only gift I'm asking for. I have been blind for too long. I want to see your power at work. I want to see how you are intervening in my life. I want to see how you are handling the situations that are hard for me to understand. I want to see, Lord, how even in this pandemic of COVID-19, your presence is visible. I want to see, Lord, your faith has healed you. Go. That is our request. That is what we are looking for. We want to see. And once we see, we're going to restore that love that we had at the beginning, knowing that God is at work, knowing that God has not abandoned any one of us. We give glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Monday to you.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread. Your bed.